afternoon. Josh and I just wanted to share some highlights of the Envoy training. Instead of having you wait until November, you need the skills now. We just thought we would provide a little bit of training here today. And then, like I said, if you have questions at any point in time, please make sure that you let us know. So we'll just get started right away. So basically, Envoy stands for Educational Nonverbal Yardsticks. And it really is a set of tools to help use when managing a classroom, students. Michael Grinder is the founder, and in his research, he actually started in high school, but he observed over 3,000 classrooms. And really what he was looking for is what common skills do highly effective teachers utilize? And so through his research, he came up with 31 different skills. Seven of them are considered the main gems, and then under each gem there are additional, we call them specialty skills. So if you're working with a demonstration teacher, you might hear him or her say that they're working on a specialty skill. The other skills are specialty skills. So today we'll focus mainly on the seven main gems, and then we've prepared a slide that's kind of like, okay, now as the educational assistant, how does this apply to me? So that's the route we'll go today. It really boils down to Envoy being all about saving our words for curriculum and building and establishing relationships. So trying to use as much nonverbal as we can as we are managing. And this is, when we first started taking it, this at first kind of seemed like, really, yeah, I don't know if I buy it. But now that I've been practicing for a few years, it really is about the actions of the adults impacting the actions of the class. And so Envoy is all about helping adults behave more systematically so that we can influence student behaviors and then prevent the need for discipline. And then Envoy is also really about providing a calm, safe environment for all of us.
And to this point, I think one thing to think of is whether, as much as we want to, whether it's the principal, whether it's the classroom teacher, whether it's educational assistant, there is not one of us that can change a student's behavior. The student's going to behave however they're choosing to behave in that moment. What we can do is we can influence how they're behaving. Now, traditionally, that's consequence, reward, whatever that might be. What Envoy really does is it shifts the focus to how can we change our behavior in that moment as adults to better influence them in that moment, whatever it is that they're being experienced. So one of the biggest, I would say, misconceptions that I hear about Envoy is, number one, it is not some form of sign language. Now, there are definitely nonverbal signals that become common across grade levels, classrooms, common spaces, but that is for the consistency, again, for the student. And really for staff as well. When we communicate, whether it's in a setting like this, whether it's standing in front of 20 to 25 seven-year-olds, high school students, whatever that might be, we are sending a message whether we know we're sending a message or not. And so the example I use is when students come into the building, and this is something I need to remind myself of often, our most comfortable position might be arms crossed, maybe leaning against the wall. That sends a message to students, whether we mean that message or not. It's not a real welcoming stance. And so when we talk posture, we talk our voice, we talk our eyes, the tone of our voice, all of those things send a message whether we want them to or not. And our nonverbals send the majority of the message. And so what Envoy is, and what we are trying to stress with Envoy is, making sure that our nonverbals match what it is that we want our audience to do or to feel. And so if I, again, using the example, if I stand with my arms folded and no smile or anything like that, as I welcome people, it's really not as welcoming as if I had a smile on my face, you know, I have an open hand pop gesture, you know, I might have more of a casual stance, you know, body posture, and that's going to send a completely different message than the first example. Now, there might be times, especially on harder days, when my intent might be to send more of a credible message to my audience. And so then I would purposefully choose to do that with my nonverbal. So, but a large percentage of our body, our voice, our eyes, even our breathing, sends what message we want to our audience. A few minutes ago, when we couldn't get the computer to work, and we knew people were coming in within 2 to 3 minutes, my breathing was rising. And so, had we not gotten it worked out, I would have had to consciously bring my breathing back down so I don't send a message to panic out to my audience. The same thing happens in our classrooms, especially on the harder days when it's, you know, we're leading up to Christmas vacation, or it's homecoming, or it's any other number of things that happen on a daily basis. Our students, our colleagues, can read it in our own actions, how we're feeling about it.
And children are just so intuitive. And so if you are high breathing because either you're surprised or you're upset, or their breathing just innately raises as well. And when you're breathing high, oxygen isn't getting to your brain as well. And then, you know, there are situations you think, why did I say that, or why did I do that? Well, I was probably high breathing and I wasn't thinking right because there wasn't the oxygen in my brain that it needed. So it's the same thing when your breathing raises, so does the students. And they say that it does take a substantial amount of time for a child's breathing to come down. So if I'm really upset and I slam the table because I'm upset and I startle everyone, now it's going to be a long time before they can really truly get back into momentum, get back into working, because their breathing has to lower and they have to calm back down.
We can't ever turn off our nonverbal. And you're probably doing it now. We do it all the time. We you know, guess what the speaker is, what the message is behind the message. Our nonverbals are never, ever turned off. And they're always there for the audience to pick up on.
So when we're talking about Envoy in the classroom, Michael Grinder broke down a lesson into 4 different phases. So there's the getting attention phase, the teaching phase, transition to seat work, and then seat work. And within each phase, the 7 gems are divided up. And so up there you can see the 7 gems. We'll go into each of them a little bit more in depth, so I'm not going to read them. But each gem fits into one of the 4 phases of the lesson. So as we were thinking about, okay, how does this all apply to our support staff? Kind of your gems, in addition to the 7 gems, we call those skills of productivity. And so it's very important that we are always low breathing. We're always slow walking. When we have to go verbal, we're using a private voice. And then the 3rd one is eyes on the prize. And so that's really, it depends on the situation. If I am trying to get a student to do their work, I'm not going to make eye contact because that's actually a sign of power. In the past, I always thought eye contact was really good, which it is in certain situations. But in a situation where I'm trying to get a student to work, if I'm making eye contact to the student, I'm really trying to use power. But if I come in, approach from the side, and I'm looking at the work, my eyes are on what I want the child to do. If the teacher wants the students looking up at the board, my eyes are also going to be at the board, because at that point in time, the prize is the board. So when we say eyes on the prize, that's what it means, just wherever the student should be looking. And then as support staff too, we always want to make sure that we're scanning the room often.
And when we, well, first of all, every classroom door has these skills of productivity on the outside. That's as much of a reminder to me as it is anybody else. When I go in and out of rooms, I know that, and it's the same for anyone, when that key turns or the handle moves, we don't have quiet classroom doors. And so all 20 heads turn to see who's coming into the classroom. So what I try to do is remember when I come into the classroom, the very first thing I do is I break eye contact. And I just look down at the ground. And that sends that message to the students, I'm not here for you. And again, it goes back to that feeling of power. If I walk into the room and I make eye contact with Joe as a student, typically their breathing automatically is going to go up. And then we go back to those nonverbals again, because they automatically assume. So I intentionally break eye contact with everyone when I walk into the classroom. I try to always walk slowly around the room, because again, we've all been around those individuals who we would not call in an emergency, because it would cause more panic. So constantly walking slowly, okay, gives that sense of, you know what, things are okay. Things are alright. Even if inside you're going, oh my goodness. You know, slow walking, and that just brings the level down. The private voice piece. And all of these things are more difficult when there are additional adults in the room. So as a support staff going in, maybe even into a room where there are already multiple adults, it makes it even more important that we are doing these things. If I'm going to have a conversation with Christina, I'm going to slowly walk to Christina, and we're just going to have that conversation privately. Because one, our students don't need to hear that message. Okay.
So in the attention-getting phase, or the getting attention phase of the lesson, there are two main gems, and that's the freeze body, and then the above, the pause. With the freeze body, really what the freeze body is communicating to the students is that, okay, I'm ready for your attention now. So even if students are, I'll use an example of this morning. I went in and was able to demonstrate in Mr. Rager's room. And so it was, the demonstration was going to start at 8:30. I was in there about 8:25. And so the kids were, some kids were doing their jobs, other kids were just watching me. I wasn't making eye contact. I was getting everything set up so that when I did really freeze my body, they knew, okay, she's ready. Where if I want their attention, but I'm getting something from here, and I need to get my marker from here, and I non-verbally, what am I going to tell them? I'm telling them I'm not ready. So I'm going to set up in silence. I'm going to make sure that I have everything set up before I actually stop and freeze, and then I'm going to get their attention with probably a pause whisper if I need to, or if they're already all attentive, then I don't even need to do that. So it's important when we are communicating with our students that our bodies are still. Again, I'm not rushing around and talking to everybody as I'm trying to teach, because again, that's not what highly productive teachers do. So we have our bodies still. We're balanced or a credible stance, and Mr. Smith talked about this a little bit before. So if I'm delivering information, I might have my body in more of a credible stance where my body is balanced. My palms might be down, versus if I'm inviting things, my palms might be up. So that's credible stance versus approachable stance might be something more like this, where I'm welcoming input.